process. This was interrupted, as I said, because the Director of National Intelligence and the administration created an atmosphere of fear and concern right before we recessed in August, and so we passed the Protect America Act. You should know I didn't vote for that. I didn't agree with that, but it was passed by the Senate. We had to take action on this side. It got the necessary votes to pass, and that's where we are today. I wanted to make sure I thanked all of you for the work that you do. You're a critical and important part of this whole process. And as a committee, we want to make sure that we give you and everyone else in the intelligence community the tools that you need to keep us safe. So thank you for the work that you do, and we will do our best to make sure that you have everything that you need to do your jobs. The El Paso Intelligence Center is important because we've done a very good job of making sure that law enforcement people from throughout the country and really throughout the world, including military, know that it's there and make it a regular source of information. Police departments, sheriff's officers, parole officers, I mean, just different people from all walks of life routinely call EPIC and say, hey, run a 28 on this guy or this vehicle or this aircraft or this vessel. So that's made a huge difference, putting it under the Intel umbrella. So much so that in a very short period of time, we're now expanding it and supporting it because it's well known. It has very good databases, but can be improved upon, and the capabilities to monitor bad guys are there. Centrally located on a 2,000-mile border with Mexico, gateway to all of Latin America, and a resource that everybody can tap into. So that's a real success story. A lot of the things that we're gonna look at are gonna be budget driven. I will tell you this: fighting this war with supplementals, it doesn't give us as a Congress the ability to hold people accountable. This is why we don't know how many contractors have been hired in Iraq, how many contractors there are. We don't know how much has been pilfered and how much. I will tell you, I was shocked on one of my first trips into Iraq that we had bird colonels going around with briefcases full of $100 bills that were going out with the troops, and if the troops blew up the wrong house, they went and negotiated. And I said, well, what about receipts? Oh, yeah, we get a receipt, but, you know, who knows what those receipts were. But that was a strategy because there was a lot of money. I mean, we still today have not gotten our hands around the many different issues or programs or strategies that have been funded willy-nilly because supplementals have made that possible. Now, supplementals, that money, that hasn't been all bad. Some of that money has given the intel agencies a lot of great capabilities, and we have seen what they've done with that have been very positive, but not all of it. I mean, you talk about a lot of the things that have been uncovered by the inspector generals, the GAO, and others. It's going to be ugly once this whole thing comes out. So funding by supplementals just doesn't work because there isn't any accountability. You can't follow and track budget-wise the way you do with a regular budget. And it gives, and also it's not fair for the agencies because in some cases, we, in the last authorization bill, we actually moved programs and projects from being funded by supplemental to the regular base budget because agencies have to plan long term. I mean, they have to make those kinds of commitments. And they're not able to if they're going to be depending on supplementals that may or may not be available next week, or, I mean, next year.